meantime, at home were his brother and his mother, who all of his mind. And not shocking, but a little bit shocking, mom and brother decided to invest his money in real estate. When they invested the money in the real estate, the problem the step that they missed was that when you buy the real estate, you got to pay taxes on the real estate. So, like municipal taxes. You get a municipal tax bill, and they say, okay, I see this. It says I owe the town of so-and-so money. And mom and his brother forgot to do it. And, of course, you know the rest of the story. They lost all the real estate. Millions of dollars of real estate were bought in homes in Irvington, New Jersey, were gone away in African-American community, probably lower class in terms of income and so on, lost it all. So, the question came at one point, and I wasn't involved at that point, the question came whether or not mom and his brother were going to be prosecuted. Well, there's no reason to know about that now. So that was one pool of money. Over here, there was another pool of money that Hoover had at the end of the day. The NBA players get pensions. They have pensions their entire life. And so they're entitled, depending on the number of years they play. They move with it play enough to go ahead and get a pension. I get a call from one of the AAU coaches who knows me because my middle son played for them and said, Luther's homeless living. Not living, but existing somewhere in Irvington, New Jersey, and he's in some bond outfit. We end up finally finding Luther, who had lost two toes in frostbite, and lost a lot of his teeth, and involved with drugs and everything like that. We finally got Luther in the funny story is, I was driving a black Hummer at that time. Somebody from the Irvington Police Department who I had represented said, Luther's on 8th Street, just off Springfield Avenue, and you know what that neighborhood is all about. I took one of my law clerks, and just by way of example, happened to be a suburban white naive kid. I said, get in the truck, Luther's on 8th Street, and I drive right into the drug corridor. It's just like it's sort of ridiculous. I drive right into the drug corridor, and I get out of the truck, and I basically, Luther's sitting on the step of one of the drug pens. And I say to Luther, get the fuck in the truck. We're out of here. And we drive down the avenue, and Luther's hanging out the window, yelling, Lou's back in the house. This is I became like a decathlon lawyer, you know what I mean? I'm dealing with drug issues, I'm dealing with 320 pounds of a mess, and there's no money. He's getting $1,000, excuse me, he's getting $3,000 a month from the NBA. But the $3,000 he's getting a month, if it could get worse, it's getting worse. Perhaps it will go up, but we're still going to get there. He gets $3,000 a month from the NBA, $10,000 a month are going to $500 each to each of his four children that he had out of wedlock from four different women. And I, I'm a very proud homo sapien, but four children from four different women, I just don't get it, okay? It doesn't even register with me, and I don't even believe any of this. So now I'm stuck with a domestic issue. I'm stuck with a real life issue. I'm stuck with finances for this time. And I'm really worried about the mother and the brother getting prosecuted. And so, as a matter of fact, one of the judges who has Luther in the court, because Luther is wandering around Irvington, New Jersey, with a lost soul, is starting to ask questions why the mother and the brother have been prosecuted. Now, I don't want to even get near this because I don't want Luther to get wrapped up in this in terms of public relations. Now, I've got another problem with public relations because I don't want him disparaged any more than he is. So, now I start going to solutions, trying to figure out what to do. I call the NBA. I call them. They're very cooperative with me. They tell me that Luther's got $375,000 in basically in his retirement. If I want, excuse me, it's not $375,000. It's actually his entire retirement based on actuarial tables. Now I become an insurance guy. It's unbelievable. Actuarial tables, it'll probably be worth $1.5 million. So I go to one of these companies in Atlanta who goes ahead and buys out settlements and pensions. They tell me they'll get $395,000 on $1 million in change. They'll buy them out of the pension right now. So I end up doing that. I get the money, I take it to court, they make me, I'm the guardian of the group right now.
Okay.
My sons are running around neighborhood telling everybody that we have a new brother, it's with the money. It becomes almost comical to visit my house to have a couple of meals, and I get it all straightened out. And I end up taking his $395,000, and I end up portioning the money out to him over 7.5, 8 years, paying his rent and everything. So it comes in, every month or so, say, I made a little bit more money than you're giving me. Luca, what do you need the money for? I'd like to buy a guitar. I say, no, I don't think the guitar works. You know what I mean? It's like, I have 3 kids, I don't need another one. But this is what I have. We got into court, and I had to cut off this whole business with the child support. Because it was huge. And by the way, he was paying the child support building. It was 500 a kid times 4 kids every month. So in New Jersey, there's a statute of limitations. After a while, he can't ask for a paternity test after a certain number of years. So now I've got to know family law, I have to know finances, I've got to watch out for the criminal stuff because Luther had busted up a couple of bars, and I have to get that off. The guy's 7'4", he likes to sing karaoke. He gets late, has a few drinks, mixes it with all the medicine that he has, and I really, it's like a walking mess. So I get into court, I talk one of the judges into ignoring the statute of limitations, because he's out of line on it, and I ask, but did the paternity test call for all women or for women? Now I have women's groups chasing me down the street, because that's not very nice to do. They all show up for the paternity test, and one child out of the 4 is his. He's already paid thousands of dollars of his MBA money to 3 other women. They must be aware of his children. Maybe he had relations with them, but the children were not his children. They were not his legal obligation. So I cut that the other issue that I had with Luther was he is walking around into New Jersey, and every drug dealer knows him, because in order to get rid of all the pain that he was suffering, including his homelessness, he would be smoking marijuana, he would be sniffing cocaine, he would be doing everything. So I had to go take him to drug counseling, get him away from the SS County prosecutor's office. One of the other things that I did for him was I took him to an orthopedist, or no, well-known orthopedist to go to New Jersey. I walked him into the orthopedist's office to make sure there was no further infection in his feet, because he had lost his toes. What's the point? I'm a fixer. I'm a repairer. I have to recognize all of these problems with this venerated sports figure in New Jersey who everybody had been making decisions for all this time. Now he sits in my office. He sits at my counsel table, and I say, Luther, this is what the situation is. What do we want to do? Luther's nowhere prepared for any of this. He has no idea what he's going to do with his life, how he's going to do this, what do I do? I call up Seton Hall University. I say, Luther hasn't finished his grades. Can we get back home? But you're going to have to pay tuition. I said, but he's on scholarship. Now I'm going to go ahead and deal with the dean and so on and so forth. At the end of putting money into the institution. But no one really knows. He's got a learning disability. That's why he wasn't really learning to begin with. So we have a learning disability elsewhere. That was a failure. That turned out to be a failure. He ends up going to one of the New Jersey State colleges where they accommodated his learning disability, and he was okay. And we got him his associate degree. Some level of self-respect. But he played basketball so long, he was in sports for so long, that he didn't know how to do anything for himself.
I mean, you can imagine a scenario if you play sports. Stand over here, running in this play, go take a shower, practice is over, it's time to go to study table. I mean, that's what happens on a collegiate type of level. What happens to people, and that's what happens. And if they never made a decision for us, if you're not taking the shot, you're just running. That's the kind of thing that I have to get through with it. And that's the kind of thing, the kind of mess that you have to face off to if you're going into this business. I mean, I've heard a lot of the agents who have come to me and they've said to me, I don't know what to do. I said, well, why are you doing it?
Well, this is not the agent.
I'm a sports agent. Shouldn't I be doing this? No, I think you should be sending a person to a physician if they're drug affected, or if there's a legal problem, to a lawyer. That's how you get these things squared away. And these are the things that you folks, I understand, in terms of your future vocations, may be facing. That's anecdote number one. Anecdote number two is Elijah Ingram, point guard from St. Anthony's High School in Jersey City, who played for St. John's. So it was sometime in the early 90s, Elijah Ingram was on this tremendous basketball team with Mike Jarvis as the coach at St. John's. They go to Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania to play the game. They go up to the game, and they go to the game. But it's Elijah's birthday, and so everybody decides to go out that night. The problem is that there is a strip club in Pittsburgh that all the big news basketball teams would visit during their visits there when they were playing it. And everybody in the Big East Commissioner's office knew about it, but nobody did anything about it. So that night, Dave Keita, who's a teammate of Elijah's, one of the other fellows, they go to the strip club. As a matter of fact, they go to the taxis, four guys in each taxi, they go to the strip club. And the next thing that happens is that Abe and another guy meet up with a lovely lady who says she's a flight attendant. She goes ahead, they apparently get amorous, and then the evening ends, and they head back to the hotel. The first taxi goes back to the hotel, and Abe and this other guy are up in the room, which Elijah starts to occupy. And they're up there in the room, and Elijah shows up. He looks at what's going on. He puts a couple of things together. He says, I don't want to be part of this room. So it's my birthday. I want you guys out of here, or her out of here. I'm going into the bathroom. Elijah goes into the bathroom. Apparently, they have a very good time. He comes out of the bathroom. She's getting dressed. At the end of the conversation, after she gets dressed, she announces to the three guys in the room, by the way, that'll be $1,000, all right? And they said, well, what are you talking about? I mean, if you're giving $1,000, and you've seen her this year before, I'm going to be able to work. Ingram has the state of mind to go ahead and turn on his cell phone. And when she extorts them, when she extorts them, he records it on his cell phone. They go down the elevator. Ingram says to her, listen, you do what you got to do. You want to call the police, go call the police. But I'm going to sit here in the lobby, and I'm not moving. Okay, so if any police are coming, I'm going to be here if you want to call them. And she does call the police. Pittsburgh police show up. Ingram has the state of mind to transfer from his phone that conversation to somebody else's phone, because he says in his own head, maybe they're going to confiscate my phone, and what do I do there? He goes ahead, he does that, they're downstairs, they're in the lobby, she's there, the police come, nobody gets arrested. They get taken into custody, but nobody gets arrested. And what ends up happening is, of course, Mike Jarvis, the coach, is slipping through this whole thing, because he has no idea what's going on. And they're at the headquarters, and they look at Ingram's telephone, and they simply hear her extort. But that's not the end of the story. There's more than that, obvious. Word has already gone over the internet. St. John's guys have raped the girl in Pittsburgh, raped the woman. No charges have been made. The entire, not only the entire administration of St. John's is waiting for them if they come back. Ingram, the other guy, and two other guys thrown off the team, thrown out of school, and there's absolutely no administrative process. So now I've become an administrative agency expert, a university process expert, besides my criminal background. I get the phone call, Ingram and Sandra in my office, I debrief him, and I get the whole story from Ingram, and I figure out what to do. I call the council for St. John's, and I said to the council of St. John's, I said, well, this seems to be a bit premature. Monsignor, whatever his name is already decided he's the president of the university. I said, the minimum due process requires a hearing. Let's have a hearing. He says, you really want to have a hearing? Yeah, I really want to have a hearing. And I said, would you like to know the facts? No, we're not really interested in the facts. I swear to God, that's exactly what he said to me. Set up a hearing, and we went to the hearing, which is essentially a conference. And Monsignor, who was president of St. John's, was sitting there, and you could see from his body language, arms crossed, sitting in the chair, the whole deal, that he wasn't going to listen to anything because the Daily News, if anybody was in New York, and the Post, had flown this all over the papers at St. John's, a Jesuit university, had turned into a problem. Okay, that's essentially what happened. And of course, I said at the conference to everybody, I said, I hope you don't trip on your way up to the moral high ground here at St. John's. That wasn't appreciated very much, and it was pretty much downhill from there. We were in the proceedings, and I said to the Monsignor, because I was frustrated and I was angry, there was no due process. Don't feel I'm a criminal lawyer, and I'm in an administrative proceeding. I said, you don't even want to know the facts. As the Monsignor was walking out of the room, and I, in my most controlled moment, said, and by the way, despite your collar, you're nothing but a racketeer. That didn't go over very well. As one of my Roman Catholic friends said to me, don't excuse me, by the way, we should call him fucking racketeer. So I said that apparently took some hold. That apparently took some hold because later that night the assistant counsel for the university decided to negotiate with me. I could have called Paul Hagan, he would have done a better job than I, but nevertheless, I negotiated that he was released from school. His transcript reflected no expulsion. He got his permission to transfer wherever he wanted to go, and all of his grades were preserved. Okay? Clean bill of health. I went into the USA today, the next day, much against my rule of no contact with the media, except to say I don't comment on pending litigation, which is usually my statement. The chief will do our talking in the courtroom and not here, and I'll get to that in a minute. And Ingram went on to Mexico State to play for Reggie Theus, was the basketball coach there. Did not make it to the NBA, and frankly, just a tremendous. Another example of what I do and how I've got to manage and juggle so many issues. Let me take a little diversion to the church for a second. Let's talk about publicity. You guys way ahead of me on social networking and everything else like that by virtue of age and time and so on. I have a very clear position that I think everybody should take if they have judgment. I have to answer to these people in black robes called judges. I also have to answer to U.S. attorney's offices and prosecutor's offices most of the time. My adversaries I'm not that worried about. But when you go into the newspapers and you start making promises that you don't know you can keep, you have a problem. And by the way, a lot of the judges, most of them are human beings, they go ahead and they read the newspapers also. They even read the blogs. They do all the same things you guys do. So you can imagine a guy who gets up in the morning and my guy sees me from him, and he reads about me commenting about Elijah Ingram, if that's what I'm doing. So the reaction, in my opinion, is, generally speaking, hey, Tills have a lot to say about this case, doesn't he? wait until he gets into my courtroom, and I'll deal with him later, and we'll see how, you know, what kind of mouth he's in. I say to everybody, and I give the law students that I lecture at Seton Hall, and the lectures at Columbia and Cardozo, I give them the same advice. Stay out of the newspaper. They want a comment from you, just say, we cannot, and it's the firm's policy, fill a comment on that new application. Mm-hmm. And of course, people are going to go ahead and say, oh my God, lawyer Jones, lawyer Smith, they were filling information and so on. And my favorite lately is, we have any information from the source that's not authorized to speak for the university or the team or anybody else. That is classic, and maybe you obviously know someone's leaking information. But don't you be the person. You've got to be, in my view, high minded. If it gets down and dirty on one particular case right now involving a professional football team, I hire PR people who come to me and say, we think we want to respond to this in the following way. Okay, if you want to plant this story and this explanation, go ahead and do it, but we're going to do it in a high-minded way so it doesn't look seamy or slimy, because what's the reason? It impacts the client. It really impacts the client. Whether you're an agent, whether you're a GM, whatever you are, your client becomes who you are. That's the whole issue. I mean, how about my clients to become invisible? One of the first trials I ever had as a young lawyer, representative, the only African-American guy, who had gone ahead and allegedly robbed somebody in their garage in a suburban home. He comes into court, he's wearing a black t-shirt and black pants. He's the only clothes he had. He looked sinister. He looked awful. So he and I were about the same size. The next day he shows up in the court with a navy blue blazer, a white shirt, a red tie, tan slacks, and loafers. So the judge says to me, is this the same guy who was here yesterday? I said, sure, it's the same guy. I'm bringing people in. He says, he looks like he just got off the UCLA team bus. We were lucky we got in a court. But the jury had a completely different issue. It was about the packaging of my client and what my client looked like, or what your client looks like. What did Ingram become? He became who his lawyer was. Unfortunately, it was on my name. Luther became who I was. And that's really the issue. Let's go to another point. There's no way that I was going to get Ingram to testify. There's no way. He sat there with a suit on. He was very nice. He was well-shaven. He was all of this expectational stuff that people are supposed to be. I know everybody now, a lot of guys go around with, they got a little bit of growth on their face, and it's all Hollywood. It's not Hollywood. And so on. And that's what I mean. But the deal is, I'm looking for it. But that's the deal, okay? So if you can do that and you can manage it, you got to manage the thing. But there was no way Ingram was testifying. There was no way Luther was testifying, because they were not articulate. So what did I become? I became the mouthpiece. Okay. Let me go down to the three. There was a guy named Lorenzo Crawford. Lorenzo Crawford was first team All-American football. Patterson Catholic High School, Patterson, New Jersey, tremendous running back, and everybody wanted it, including a good student from a very lucky family, went to Notre Dame. End of his freshman year, beginning of sophomore year, he was living in a house with three other football players, and what ends up happening is, a woman shows up who's gone out with several of the guys, and the situation is totally consensual. Three out of the four guys have relations with her. Lorenzo does not have relations with her. What he's doing is he's downstairs doing something else. The next thing that happens is, and there's it was at that time a specific rule at Notre Dame, that there was no fraternization of the other sex on campus. But where the house was located was not on campus, but they called it on campus. Okay. she goes home, someplace in Indiana. She goes in and tells her mother. The next thing,
yep,
it's another rape case.
Okay.
Another rape case. I'm not minimizing that in any way, shape, or form, but it's just a repeat circumstance of what apparently happens on college campuses indiscriminately between men and women. And it's, I can't, it's not a social comment that I'm going to get into. The answer for our first thrown out of my head, he doesn't get anything written. He doesn't get anything. He is charged by the state attorney general's office. He is now facing criminal charges in Indiana. And I started with the questions. Of course, I've already lived in there, and so there's a little bit of a wrinkle that happens here. And I say to myself, and why did I believe the arrest? Why did I believe? So I ultimately go ahead under attorney client privilege and work product. I hire a polygraph, lie detector. I get one of the reputed best guys in Indiana. I have Lorenzo sit down. I have him also tested in New Jersey by my guy that I think is the best. But I have a guy in Indiana who has sway with all the prosecutors. Lorenzo tells a story. I ask him, is Lorenzo telling the truth? He says, absolutely telling the truth. Go ahead, go to the prosecutor. I go to the prosecutor, and I say to the prosecutor, look, this is what happened. He had nothing to do with this. We don't think so. The girl says this. The girl's not telling you the truth. Okay? She's not telling you the truth. And I say, by the way, if you want to put another polygraph, put another polygraph. That was the signal to them that I had already done it. And I knew what the outcome would be. But under normal circumstances, you would never make that kind of boasting offer. You would go ahead and you would do it and proceed by being prepared first and then make your position. They did not accept. They went. It was trial day after trial day after trial day over a period of 2 years. Lorenzo did not get back into Notre Dame. He ended up being a small college of America at Tuskegee Institute, which is right by my work. And now works for one of the banks in New York because he has no criminal record because they never prosecuted him. Because she decided, somebody decided, it was not worth the trouble to go to a criminal trial in the U.S. However, as I promised you, there was another problem. Okay? This is always another problem. She filed a lawsuit against Notre Dame and against each of them individually for civil penalties or them, I don't know. She had been going to psychological counseling. She wanted to pay for that. She wanted to be paid for it. Only one of the defendants ultimately settled. I refused to settle. I wouldn't settle. It went away. So I got 100% of that test. But the one thing I could not recapture for Lorenzo was I couldn't recapture his draft status with the NFL. No team would touch him because of that incident. And I could not get him back his reputation. Just couldn't get it back. Everybody knew. He came back to New Jersey very quietly. He got a job with one of the Fortune 500 companies or banking institutions. He's working there. He's doing that. He has a family. He's gone on with his life. But he's never lived up to the billing that he had. And I think this is something that he truly, truly presents.
So, I ask a question more generally.
Yeah, sure.
Because, we're seeing so much both on news campus and around the country of this phenomenon of school student/staff run basically judicial hearings that aren't judicial hearings, but that have the consequences of something, pretty grave.
Right.
And I wonder if you could talk more generally about that direction and whether you think that it's sustainable, what goes on in those types of hearings that seem to make the school think that it's the right path to take.
Most of the schools that I have been at with students in these situations, most of the time they've been advocates. Don't ask me why that is. There is no entitlement to counsel in those hearings. kind of somewhat me. And I forced my way into the St. John's situation. I wasn't going to let that happen. And I frankly threatened them and said I would go to the Daily News, who will print anything of that anything. And I went to I was going to go to the Daily News and tell them that that's why I got in there. But for example, I was here, believe it or not, I was aggrandized with a very big problem. And they would not let me in the administrative proceeding. They had a student who was signed from the law school or something like that who was going to represent my client. It was a very big problem because the circumstances under which that kid at Randolph was involved were truly criminal issues involving drugs. So now the question becomes, to your point, now the question becomes, if he testifies at the administrative hearing, is that testimony usable and producible to the law enforcement authorities? In other words, who raised the Sixth Amendment right to remain silent? I mean, who is there to tell him that his rights are being incriminated? It's a slam dunk. I mean, anybody would know that. And by the way, let me just say this. The issue of the prosecution's on-campus phenomenon is not a phenomenon. It's been going on for a long time, but people accept it. Quietly accepted the punishment. Go away for a year. Don't ever come back. Whatever the solutions were, it was very kept very quiet. And I think if there is social media, it's that's why it's getting pushed out of front.
Why do schools think it's a good idea? I mean, it seems like so fraught with potential conflict of interest and diminution of the rights of the student and elimination of the right to counsel. Is it what Title IX demands? Or I ask both of you about it.
What do you think? I actually think the Justice Department is quite clear that schools have a responsibility to the right to counsel. But do they have a responsibility to take this away? In every school that I've been to, they show me their procedural charts. And it says that almost all of them, the student is not entitled to counsel because they believe it is a university problem, which gets us to the famous institutional issue. But
you now get on that. I mean, clearly one of the things that's going on, and you've already laid it out,
in a case like Wilford, he's already, there's a big mess, and they're trying to clean up on that.
Right.
With Ingram, you've got a little bit of the managing of an information flow, although I remember that coming out. Again, it's out. The damage is already done. What do you do in a situation where there is high levels of risk, but there's some possibility of still keeping things out of the press, out of paper? How do you go about managing that kind of space where there are multiple potential risks? I can give you some badly out of date now, but Princeton athlete was charged, there was an internal Princeton proceeding. His counsel got an injunction against the Princeton proceeding, right? Until the end of the criminal matters. You know, that's a slightly different issue. Again, it's public, but it's a fundamental issue, too, that people have to recognize as their agents or their representatives or their legal representatives, and it goes like this. If anything your client would say would incriminate them criminally, obviously you want to do that. So I do a thing of being proactive as a legal practitioner. I want to close as many doors and stats as I can. So, A, you've heard me already talk about me debriefing my clients. Debriefing them until I have a working memorandum, factual memorandum, with documents to back up everything I'm saying if I can, photographs if I can, tape recordings if I can. Let me just give you an example, okay? I'm representing a guy, an athlete, who's charged with sex offense. He he goes ahead, and the allegation goes that they were in the car, and in the, while they were in the car, the athlete with the girl, who is 10 years, and that's really the problem, and it makes it even more dicey, is allegedly photographing the event with his cell phone. And certainly not the cinematographic purpose. That's the first thing. That's the first thing I'm hit with. That's the first thing I'm hit with by the prosecutor. The guy's going to jail. It's 10 to 20. Why don't you think about a plea and everything like that? And I go, it's so much humorous. But could we have a trial? Maybe we should have a trial and figure out if what's being said is true. I call one of my cyber guys, who was the former head of cyber stuff. He was the attorney's office now. He says to me, and I'm playing this like I'm doing this, but he says to me, you know, phones have hard drives. I said, hey, that's cool. All right, that's good. Does that computer have hard drives? I said, can you get down in the hard drive? He said, not a problem. Now, who's got the phone? The law enforcement authorities have the phone. So I go ahead, I file a motion to your point. I file a motion to the court. I freeze the phone. They can't look at the phone. I can't look at the phone. Now, they've charged my client based upon the probable cause laid out by the female. And the female's mother. She's a 10 years, the mother is there. And she, the mother says, where were you? Where were you last night? Why did you come home at 2 o'clock in the morning? And instead of saying that I had consensual sex, even though I'm underage, she says I was raped. Bang! Here we go. The party started, and everybody said the prosecutor's office. So they haven't even looked at the phone yet. I go ahead and get a court order that everybody, including the prosecutor's office technician and my technician, can look at the phone at the same time. All right? Being drilled down into the hard drive, there's no photographs. There's no film like she suggested. There is film of him having sexual relations with his girlfriend, but it's not her. So now the landscape has substantially changed. And by the way, what are his parents worried about besides the mental health counseling he should get? And should be getting for the stupidity that he pulled. They're worried about her suing him civilly, ultimately, for her mental problems. And by the way, I don't know her, never met her, she's a child, and that's the end of the deal. But the whole landscape changed. Now the prosecutor's office is backing up and realizes their case is not as good as they originally thought. So, to Professor Hagen's position, I got an eye out for whether he can get sued civilly, ultimately, some kind of restitution. She has to go see a psychiatrist for the next 10 years, or she needs this, or it needs that, or anything else like that. And then I've got the criminal on the criminal side, where he could be facing 10 to 20 years under the New Jersey statutes. This is an athlete out of Rutgers University. Very big problem that I had dissipated that problem. So you had the polygraph situation with Lorenzo Crawford. With this guy, I had the cyber stuff digging down into the hard drive on the telephone. I had problems with him also, where I had to go to the hard drive because they had gone ahead and gotten a warrant for his computer because of all the email traffic between them. He met this girl on one of the chat rooms. And it's a chat room called Chat Mode. Okay? I can get humorous about that, but it's the sleaziest possible chat room imaginable. I mean, every child pornographer is on this chat room, and I only know that because I've represented a couple of them, and it's a very interesting milieu of people. But anyway, athlete, child pornographer. Anyhow, so we went to the computers. And we had to go on the computers, and we had to see what was going on the computers between the chats. Lascivious conversation, and so on and so forth. Just a footnote, I represented an NCAA coach, and I'll get to him in a second, basketball coach. And the NCAA came, and they were trying to establish whether or not they had anything on this computer. when they said to me, "Can you see his computer?" I said, "Sure, you can see his computer." And they were very surprised, Nancy, the way that I was so willing and happy. I said, "Well," they said, "Well, where's the computer?" I said, "You see that closet door? The computer's in the closet, in the box that it came in. He never uses a computer. So have as much fun as you want with an unused computer that has no emails or anything on it." Okay? This guy that I was representing from Rutgers, he had all sorts of lascivious comments with the scroll on the emails and everything else like that. So that's another problem. From when I started practicing, I'm now dealing with huge technical issues and different ways that people communicate with each other in terms of these types of things.
Now, so before we ever leave this, it is kind of a thing that struck me in your account of gaming. You essentially gave up his place at St. John's. You were ready, essentially, to short circuit that proceeding by having him.
I felt that he was looked on as an African American man. I felt he was looked on as if he was some kind of animal. It was no different than, in my view, was the Queens, New York, was no different than the Antebellum South. That there was going to be no justice, and it was time for him to move on and move on.
But that's essentially one of the things. And just how you're managing multiple fora. So one of them is his potential criminal liability, potential civil liability. There, you have got him out of St. John's and got him out of that proceeding.
Right.
How do you go about, when do you think you're going to try to fight to keep him in school, fight that proceeding, and say, you know, the criminal risk is low?
I felt that, as with many athletes and many sports professionals, I felt that above and beyond, it was a reputational issue that I was dealing with. I thought that I had control over the facts, whether they wanted to believe them or not. After all, I'm not a psychiatrist, I'm not a rabbi, I'm not a priest, I'm an athlete. I take the best facts I can get, and I go with them as hard as I can, and for as long as I can. So my judgment was I had to get him away from that exposure, but the exposure was also the reputation exposure. To answer your question more specifically, it was for sure that I made calls to other NCAA basketball coaches. A lot of the people in this room who watch basketball know the expression that he was a backward guy who could break people's ankles when he crossed over the ball. He was unbelievable. So I called at that time Ben Howell at UCLA. I called any number of people. They were able to touch him. They remembered him from St. Anthony's, who's been the number one high school basketball team in the United States for a long time with the Hurleys, but no one would touch him. But Las Cruces, New Mexico, is a long way from Jersey City and St. John's. Reggie Theus was taking on a lot of guys with financial problems, and Reggie had no problem after speaking with me about everything that had happened in the case. So to answer your question, I had to deal with a reputational issue, and that, I think you're right. I think it's almost as difficult obstacle to go through as these kinds of things. No question. And you have to remember that when you're representing these people or whatever position you're in. Over dinner we spoke about supervisory liability. Some of you in this room may aspire to be the general manager of some franchise, baseball or basketball. The question you have to answer is whether or not, whether you have a code of conduct and you tell them the NFL is struggling with their new code of conduct right now because they don't know how to do it, except I've told some of the owners, you got to educate your players and re-educate them. Not everybody comes from a, not everybody has a judgment. Let's put it like that. And the fact of the matter is, if you go ahead into a bar in some major city, and there are women swimming all over you, you have to understand that that's a bad situation, and you don't want to live like a monk, you'd like to have a social life, but it's a very big problem. So the point I'm making is that a lot of the general managers that I've spoken with, I've told them they
educational programs for their players. In fact, the NFL, although they're not announcing it, are literally directing the teams to go ahead and have these programs. I'm an Ohio State guy. I go to campus and do a two-day seminar with the incoming freshmen, one day with the men and one day with the women. And we talk about everything, including social media, sexual harassment, domestic violence, conducting themselves as citizens of the universal right and suffering, because there are sensitive issues that I think I have to not have a female lawyer with me also, because we discuss certain issues with the women that we have the sex for example, let's give you an example that is a bit of a problem. Whether it's man to man or woman to woman or man to woman, sexual harassment can occur. And I felt it was unseemly for me to discuss with women the issue of homosexuality. I didn't see it was any different between homosexual relationships between men and men or women and women. But I chose and made the decision that I did not want anyone to even think that I was trivializing it. And I was trivializing those personal relationships, which are personal relationships. There was one situation I had in Princeton where a young woman went down to Princeton to play softball. She was also an All-State tennis player. She went to Princeton to play softball. She was off the softball team in 3 days because she was sexually harassed. That was it. I went down there, I resolved everything with Princeton. It was not going to be a lawsuit or anything like that, but Princeton was very worried about that type of thing happening. Okay? And that's just why we have the discussion, and the discussion is done in a location where no one can media pick it up. I go in there very quietly, and we have all the discussions about the do's and don'ts, and that the men and women, they are no different. They are no different. And that's what the supervisory responsibility is all about. All the athletic directors, all the GMs, all the coaches are worried about what they can't control and what they can't do. Again, we're committed to having a discussion about can a GM of an NFL football team that carries a roster of 56, with the taxi guys, 56, but then maybe carry some practice guys. Okay. Can the head coach and the GM really know about what everybody is doing? They go to practice in the NFL sphere, and then they either go home to their girlfriends or go home alone. Or go to their girlfriends or their wives or whatever they go. So there's none of this, like the teams all together type of thing in college. Everybody's gone in disparate directions. How does anybody know? How does any GM know that these guys are out at bars or coming to shows or anything else like that? A lot of the general managers have gone and hired their own security groups. They literally follow the folks who are not on the teams are. They follow them around and make sure they also have relationships with law enforcement. And if there's something that happens, someone gets a report fairly quickly, and they try and obviously absorb any problems that might occur. So that's really the issue of the what I call the supervisory liability. And I watch that. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, no, it just seems like the taking a proactive approach with the players could possibly be a double-edged sword because once you get involved in recommending a course of action, like it better work. You know what I'm saying? So if there was like a list of, bars, and it was like these ones are don'ts, these ones are do's. Something happens and the record that you said are okay, it just seems like some teams may actually want to purposely be more hands off. But they're lies about it at the end.
There's an expression that I use in front of juries when I'm in these situations. And the expression is a little bit bifurcated. But I always say to them, everyone in America today, is willing to take responsibility. No one's willing to take the blame. Okay? So work on that, not just myself. And then the church is looking. And I have to repeat it.
what I mean by that is, when you were a GM, when you were at the head of an organization, by the way, before coming down here tonight, I read the Harvard Business Review on corporate responsibility, and it's just kind of like a refresher. This is no different than looking at the issue of corporate responsibility in the course of a corporation. That's what you guys are really talking about. And the problem is, without being proactive, the GM has no legal position, or leader of the organization has no legal position to go ahead and say, you know what, you're terminated. Because now we want you to live, right? Because you're terminated. There was a clause in your contract, you had to be a good behavior guy. You weren't a good behavior guy, bang, you're out of the organization. Because there was some responsibility on the employer to go ahead and monitor the behavior of the employee, even after hours. So we've got the dynamic of the reputational dynamic, and then we've got the legal dynamic over here, the kind of labor law management employee-employer relationship thing that's all got to be managed. And if it isn't managed, then who's it going to fall to? It's going to fall to the leader, and the leader doesn't want to get fired. And so let's talk about Jim Trussell. And Jim Trussell was the football coach for a statement recently about 3 years ago. There were allegations that Terrell Pryor and others were selling their helmets, their shoulder pads, and anything else that they could sell to make extra money. And there was a lack of institutional control. They also went to one particular location in Columbus where they went ahead and got tattoos. And it was discovered that there was a quid pro quo for the tattoos. They were handing over signed helmets, which then could be sold to the fellows who were out on the market selling all of this stuff. And so everybody got really upset because it's clearly an NCAA violation. The NCAA violation being there was a benefit to an athlete that wasn't available to all the other students. Of course, I
just these helmets that they
somebody gave them a helmet that they signed, or they're taking their own.
I just cracked my helmet. Can I get a new helmet?
Okay.
And then there was a lot of helmets, and there was a lot of footballs, and frankly, Easton Mall, the footballs. Wednesday night they would get 350 per ball, 350 per ball. Thursday night they got closer to game day than 500 per ball. So it was quite a, and they were called the entrepreneurs. This group of guys, they were. So Coach Trussell is the boss. He's the boss. So Coach Trussell, by the way, let me do a little self note. Ladies and gentlemen, the cases I get involved in a lot of the time are where people lie about what happened, not because of the substance of what happened. Right? The U.S. Attorney calls it willful blindness, they call it perjury, they call it obstruction of justice, they call it false swear. Okay? What ended up happening was there was an inquiry by the university, in my judgment, it was wholly inadequate. And Coach Trussell was left, as they say, holding the bag, no pun intended, for what everybody else had ignored. I mean, it was well known amongst the football players, it was well known amongst a lot of people that this group of guys was out because they wanted to make some extra money and do what they wanted to do. So, go ahead.
I also remember vaguely something about Trussell was trying to one or more of the players from something
this was the former player who went ahead and reported to Trussell that in fact some of this activity was going on with a particular drug dealer in Columbus. And the drug dealer, what ended up happening was Trussell did not report that to the university.
Right.
He did not report that to the university and
call a lawyer who is a former player to try and go ahead and straighten it out, which may be the universe. So the essential allegation, again, is trust is not at the NCAA level in Ohio State, was that he had failed to go ahead, as the CEO of football, he had failed to go ahead and proceed with an investigation and, frankly, a disclosure, which they characterized as a cover-up.
Okay.
So one thing led into another, and the NCAA got involved. Coach Kessel was terminated by the university. There was a resolution of his departure, which I can't discuss, from the university, but the NCAA got into the picture. Many of you may remember that he ended up getting a 5-year order to show cause, which means that within 5 years, if he wanted to coach anyplace else, he would have to, the school that he was going to go to would have to show cause why he had rehabilitated himself and was a better person and didn't violate the rules anymore. In the midst of all of it, they fired Phil Fulmer from Tennessee, and Tennessee came knocking, and everybody made the decision that that was not a good idea for him. It's incredibly good in Knoxville and the Rocky Mountain. So there we go. So what's the deal with Tressel? Tressel was is important to you. The important learning thing about it is that the person at the top will be held responsible no matter what was going on. He was alleged to be directly responsible. But there were people under him who knew full about what was going on. I said to you could probably assume that the athletic director knew exactly what was going on. The Tressel was the one who ended up taking a huge fall. Here's what's important. Preparation. He was represented by a lawyer out of Birmingham, Alabama, who had been on the infractions committee at the NCAA for 12 years, a guy named Gene Marsh. I don't know Gene Marsh, I've never met him, I've never had a conversation with him. But it ended up happening is that Tressel was scheduled to be appearing before the NCAA. And we didn't have a discussion about what to and how to analyze him and how to analyze Ohio State. Ohio State had already thrown itself on the sword. And Tressel was the one who was going to take the beating. I discovered after Jim called me, he got to me by calling me because he knew I had represented people before. I tried to be discreet about it, but he knew that I had been in situations like this before at the NCAA. We found out that Jim wasn't prepared for the grilling that was going to occur at the NCAA. So at the NCAA, I said to Jim, do you have any idea what the room you're going to be in looks like, where you're going to be scrutinized? He said, I have no idea. I said, well, you are going to be sitting in the middle of this is about half the moon. You're going to be sitting in the middle of a seat. Everybody's going to be around you. You're going to be there. You're going to be there with your kids. Did anybody tell you that? I said, well, here's a diagram of the room. Because I had it from the auditors. He said, they're going to ask you questions. You're going to have to answer the questions quite correctly. The record is not public, but you know they're going to go ahead and tell ESPN eventually what they're going to do. I said, what time is the hearing start? He said, I think it starts at 10 o'clock. How long do you think the hearing is going to go? He says, oh, I don't know. It's probably quite a while. I said to Jim, I said, the hearing is going to last maybe 45 minutes. He said, how do you know that? He said, they're going to be in their mind. They already made their mind. They got the report from the Ohio State General Counsel. This report, in my opinion, was scurrilous and perjurious. Okay? They didn't have to give the full report. But you, as the CEO of some sports professional team, are going to be asked to do an internal report at some point in time. And the question is, how do you want the report to go? I would hope it's truthful and not withhold. This report withheld certain salient facts, which was to say, other people who were in. So Jim flew out of clothes, came to my office, and I'm describing this to you just to tell you what I do, and these are things you might think of. And I brought him to my office, and I took him to my jury consultant. I had 12 people behind a window. I sat Jim in a chair for 7.5 hours. I go with him while my jury consultant grew up through rational objections. At the end of 7.5 hours, Jim was prepared to appear before the NCAA with respect to any question they would ask. I gave him a meat, I gave him a bottle of water, I gave him a bathroom, I gave him everything I could give him. We went down, we went over to Indianapolis, as we had a bet. We had a bet on the if I was right about 45 minutes, I got to play Scioto Country Club, where Jack Nicklaus started. And if he was right, I had to take him. So I was right. And that was the end of that. 45 minutes. The other 45 minutes, which added up to an hour and a half, which is about 11:30, 11:45, is the last minute people were sitting outside. You know, the NCAA couldn't go ahead and say, yeah, we talked this trestle for 45 minutes and then come out with a decision. They had to make a vote. You know, they just voted something substantial. You know, they didn't go to lunch and take a lunch break. They talked about nonsense for another 45 minutes and then everybody came out at 5 minutes after the vote. That was it. It was 125 minutes. That was it. I had planned for 7 hours. That's the issue. And by the way, the athletic director was never asked a question. The president of the university was never asked a question. No one else was asked questions as a student about what happened in a department at the Ohio State University. Okay. No different.
Go ahead. So in the recent Jim Danner case, clearly the NCAA is taking the position that you're the captain of the ship. Whether you actually know about it or not, you're responsible for the things that happen. Other people have. Do you want
to? No, that was the right thing.
Other people have said it's not fair to impose that kind of responsibility on someone who doesn't know about the infraction or bad behavior. What do you think is the right approach from the standpoint of the NCAA or more generally about how to assign blame or responsibility in a situation where you don't want to incentivize the person at the head of the organization to not know anything because that is not the...
I don't understand in the Syracuse scenario, and I think this is egotistically with Robert Bayheim more than anything else, is that he was, in the NCAA findings, shouldering all the blame. And the fact of the matter is, no university president, no university vice president, no one else was held responsible for anything. So to really get to the basis of it, no matter what organization you're running, you want to do an investigation. You want to do a real investigation. By the way, let's be realistic about the investigation. There's some people who aren't going to talk to you. Because they just don't want to talk, and we'll talk about the Sandusky thing in 2 seconds. We're talking about it over dinner. But shockingly, he stood there and had to take the hit from everybody. And he took it. I guess he was a loyal soldier. I don't know what was in it for him to go ahead and do that. But why weren't the former athletic directors? Why weren't the former vice presidents in charge of athletics? Why weren't any of those people held responsible for what the allegations were with regard to the academic misconduct and so on and so forth? And I don't think, as a former athlete, I think it's unfair to throw it all on the athletic department. There have to have been other people. And so go after those other people. That's a complete investigation. That's what we would call injustice.
But the NCAA doesn't have jurisdiction over them.
They only have jurisdiction over the athletics, but I think, especially with the North Carolina situation, there's a collision of forces there. The NCAA cannot put on the table. By the way, to be fair, we discussed this over dinner, and very frankly, the NCAA is going to be, in our opinion, they painted themselves into a corner. They don't know what to do about their authority to go ahead and discipline the university. And whether or not this is, as we were discussing, an accrediting agency's job to go ahead and discipline the university on academic issues. I mean, after all, what is the NCAA know about? In the real world, they do know that they don't have a certain grade point average in Yale and all this other stuff, and they know how to sign college contracts. So that's okay, but presumably, what do they know about academics and what they're doing? So about the same dozen kids.
Their former chief of the FBI, Louis Frank, was engaged by the head of state to go ahead and put a report together about the Sandusky matter. Louis Frank went ahead and spent $2.7 million to put together a 245-page report that was statutory in that report. You're going to see that coming soon. The president of Penn State at that time, a guy named Greg Spanier, one of the most highly regarded university presidents in the country. Curley, who was the athletic director, and then the vice president, who supposedly was the guy who was involved in the cover up, so called cover up. Help me out with the word, I think. I've got the same thing right here. So, what happens is, after the Frame report comes out, everybody who has no other life, everybody starts pouring through the 245 pages that will be made. Because I can't even believe all this stuff, because I'm involved with representing a lot of universities, so on and so forth. I get called to a school in Columbus who says to me, "We need to review this report with us because we want to make sure that nobody is, none of this is happening to us." I review the report with them, and then I tell them, "Here's another report out." And they shout in their tracks, not to be overly dramatic about it. There's a firm in Philadelphia that's been hired by President Spanier, A.D. Curley, and the vice president. And it's the Shader, Harrison, Siegel, long established, very highly regarded firm. They go ahead and go to their credit, and Stephen Pellet Council, they write a 65-page report, something that people can really get their teeth into. Erudite, tight, clean, and this is what happens. They find out that Mike McQuarrie was sheep. Anybody not know who Mike McQuarrie is? He's the quarterback who became a coach, who was in the shower, who allegedly saw Sandusky slapping a kid on the behind. And maybe other things. That's who Mike McQuarrie is. Legendary high school quarterback in Pennsylvania, and really a very good athlete for Penn State. What they find out is McQuarrie had been seeing a psychiatrist, not in the free report. They find out that McQuarrie had been seeing a psychiatrist for a long time, not in the free report. They find out that McQuarrie had his own experiences. Child molestation in his life, not in the free room. They find out that the psychiatrist had never been interviewed by the team that was put together for $2.7 million, former head of the FBI. They never interviewed the psychiatrist. They never even attempted to interview the psychiatrist. Now, I'm just going to start telling you what this was over. His patient, doctor, privilege, as well as associate. When the report came out by Free, the privilege was waived. It was gone. They never interviewed that psychiatrist. And it's my opinion that if they ever take this case to trial, finally, criminally, in Pennsylvania, because it's a clinical hot potato, I believe they're going to be acquitted. I think they're going to be acquitted, and I think they're going to.
Is that right?
Oh, yeah, I think
Sandusky will be.
No, not Sandusky. They will be. Stanier and the athletic director. I believe they will be acquitted because there is that, and I'm going to your criminal law courses, that failure to disclose is so material to what the case is about. It's absolutely positively insane. It is a fact that given to a jury, the jury could literally find that the burden of proof beyond a reasonable doubt was never met. I mean, you have to remember what the charges against them are. The charges against them, again, are failure to disclose, failure to tell the truth, failure to investigate. And by the way, there's a concept that you all need to know about, whether you're GMs or you're head of any athletic organization. This concept that the United States government wants to use
in prosecutions is called willful blindness.
Okay.
Imagine one of the unwiser clients they have horses, they put blinders on so they can't look out all over because they just focus on pulling the cart ahead, you know, and so on. The government calls it willful blindness. So if you're the head of an organization, you're the AD in Iowa, and you know something's going on in your athletic department, but you don't exactly want to find out about it. So you say to one of your assistant ADs, would you make sure our academic program is solid, we're on solid footing and everything? That's willful blindness. For example, not a very strong example, okay? You're the head of a corporation, you see we're losing money, but you do nothing about it, you send your vice president to investigate why the corporation's losing money. When there are rumors around that your bookkeeper is stealing money, and you have stockholders to answer to, and you don't do anything about it, I mean, you don't even force your assignee, whoever the person is, you're told to look at it, that's called willful blindness. You knew it was happening, there's a reasonable likelihood you knew when it was happening, the circumstances were all connected together, or you knew it was happening, or it could happen, or there was a potential. That's how vague that theory is. And when the government runs out of direct evidentiary theories, they go to willful blindness, as in Graham Spanier, Penn State, I mean, the guy acted like it, right? He was talking to Paterno, or Paterno, the arrest of these, he had to know what Sandusky was doing. So to take the example, Paterno is overseeing 105 athletes, 85 scholarships, 20 walk-ons, the managers, the equipment guys, everybody else, the guy who drives the tractor trailer every day, he's overseeing everybody. The television contracts, how is he supposed to know? Except there are people who came forward and said there have been some conversations about Sandusky, and that's why Sandusky had been released in 1996. But he still was allowed to go to camp, he was still allowed to meet with kids, and so on and so forth. And I'm not talking about Jared Sandusky's alleged, he's not guilty, he's no longer alleged, but his proclivities to whatever he was doing, okay? Including his dysfunctional son who still accounted to him too, and her wife who said nothing. Folks, this is what I face. You draw on a black blackboard, I got arrows coming at me all over the place. I'm trying to knock the arrows out of the way so I can find my way out of the circle and get to some kind of a conclusion. And sometimes, shockingly, I lose. I lose, I don't get an acquittal, but I get maybe a lesser sentence, and it's called damage control. So that's one of the things that I came to speak to you about. Is the damage control issues that you have to face, that I face every day in my business, whether I'm addressing sports people. I haven't represented any celebrities as a colleague who does that when they get into trouble, but those are the kinds of things. So you got to figure out what your strategy is going to be, all right? Are you going to have some kind of a directional manual? Are you going to have some kind of a book? Are you going to have something that goes and tells everybody what your expectation is? Because I think today, in college athletics and professional athletics, in some instances, it has gone the way of sexual harassment. And that is, there's a zero tolerance policy. Because everybody is trying to do what? Save their jobs. That's what they're trying to do. So, if an organization announces that they have a zero tolerance policy, and by the way, I have cross-examined in courtrooms, CEOs of companies who go ahead and say they didn't know that this was happening, or they didn't know that was happening. These are people who are put on the stand by the U.S. Attorney or the prosecuting authority and say, Jones had a tendency to spend a little too much time in the bathroom. I'm getting ridiculous. Okay. Or he was seen on his computer watching pornography that made him, a Lindbergh kidnapper. I have no idea where this is going, okay? But the point I'm making is you have to figure out a strategy. So you have to make a decision. If you're going to be that CEO, you're going to be that manager. Are you going with a zero tolerance policy? You probably won't have too many friends. Okay? It'd be lonely at the top of this. Or do you go ahead and figure out some kind of strategy that's going to be some kind of gradual
tolerable rate of zero,
zero tolerance. If you're looking at the law straight out,
it is zero tolerance.
There is no discrimination.
Someone made an inquiry of me in New Jersey, we have criminal discrimination statutes. So I get a lot of those cases. So, you know, in offices where I gone ahead and advise to the law firms, I've said to them, you can't come in anymore to the office and look at a female employee and say, gee, you look lovely today. You can't do that. You can't do all those types of things. I happen to teach a course at one of the law schools in New York. It's called sexual harassment. It's not too far from domestic violence. The dean was too happy with that title. He thought it was a little disrespectful, but I was trying to make a point that there is a very close proximity of the two. The sexual harassment element is somehow, sometimes, a lead up to the domestic violence situation. So let's try this example. There's a general manager of a particular professional team, and he's going ahead and he's having a wild and woolly relationship with an employee. The relationship gets totally out of hand. They're in Washington, D.C., and I get a phone call because they both got drunk. They both got drunk, and they were beating the living daylights out of each other. So now comes, you know, this is a French guy, Strauss-Kahn deal. The maid walks in. There's a maid walking in all of these scenarios. The maid walks in, she gets all excited because she's worried about her immigration status. She's asking about her immigration status. And then she reports it, and the next thing the police are there. Now, first of all, should the GM have been with an employee, whether he's married or not, it has a wonderful family. They were all consensual, but they both got drunk and they went crazy, and they were putting the moving daylights out of each other. There's the problem. It started with sexual harassment. So now what is she going to say to the police? Well, he's my boss, he put me up to this, okay, I was with him, all right, you know, all of those problems, and it's all piling up on the GM. It's all piling up on his job. They're supposed to be up on this, you know, on this level here. The GM of the so-and-so team, they have family events, it's a family team, the NBA is wonderful, it's all inclusive, except that she has a domestic violence, right, because he's beating the woman. It's just the way it is. A quick funny anecdote about domestic violence. I get called by one of the judges in the state court of New Jersey, and this is the only funny thing that I've ever said. I'm going to say that. Okay. And he says, can you come down on Friday? The person who stands in for our pro bono representations can't be here. And Friday is domestic violence. It's a domestic violence. And so, Judge, I'm honestly, apparently, he says, everybody goes out drinking Thursday night. And all hell breaks loose, and we have a lot of people who are at risk. So, okay, that's so I walk into the courtroom and I see my client, small diminutive tooth, my fault, who's supposed to be in the and he looks horrible. He looks like he got the living day last year. I walk over and I say, how are you? I'm Peter Zillin. I'm your attorney here today. And I said, but you look terrible. What happened to you? Like, you're the defendant. What's the favor? He says, well, he's like, the time is when I got picked up by the police, because my girlfriend called them because we got into a fight. And so what happened? Like, how can you arrest? Well, she called the police to me. 5 minutes, I get all those facts from him that she had really taken it to. And you know, just by way of example, she walks into the court in 10 minutes later, the testimony is this. She's one of the largest women I've ever seen, ever seen. And I look at her and you know, this is, you know, not to make a joke, there's a lot to cross examine. Anyhow, so she sits down in a chair and suddenly she's got a t-shirt on. And the t-shirt says, Save Madonna, for your own.
See, there's one street, Broad Street, and it is just loaded with 5 and 10 cents stores made by t-shirts for $1. Okay? And she barks at me and says, I've got Elizabeth and everything. And then finally, I've got the big question because I'm certain, right? I'm certain. I'm not really getting to the substance of it. The judge is hysterical about it. Because he knows exactly what's going on. I said, how do you feel when you wear that t-shirt? And I'm now gone to the board and I go, see, that's what I'm going to do. And she's now grizzled. She's gone grizzled. And she stands up in the chair. The judge says, sit down in your chair. Sit down in your chair. And move out of your chair. We're going to take a look. And he comes back. He comes back after she's shown all of her empathy and all of her hate. And she's there, and the judge comes back and says, Mr. Till, do you have a motion? I said, I'd like to make a motion to dismiss. I don't think there's any question about who the aggressor was in this case. Granted. And that was not the end of it, but that was just ridiculous, a ridiculous, you know, lawyer argument. But let's just go ahead and describe it for a second. You have to recognize that there is a polarization that goes on. What do I mean by that? What I mean by that, there are preconceived notions. There are preconceived notions. There are stereotypes. There are expectations that people, because of the way they were raised, are living. Did I ever think that I was going to be listening to my lifetime black music? Where everyone would have a scatological statement, okay? That there were words that were going to be uttered by entertainment artists that were talking about, you know, gang rapes or violence or whatever you want to do. You have to decide how you're going to handle those conceived notions. If you're going to make a plan for yourself, you got to recognize, you got to keep your eyes open for the conceived notions. You have to recognize disintegration. Okay. Disintegration means the absence of any process leading to some good faith analysis. You got polarization, stereotypes. You drop down to disintegration, there's nobody doing anything. It's like the rush to judgment. That's what you're facing in your business. That you've got, that you're dealing with human beings. And again, I'm not going to minimize people going into the sports leadership business. They are just the same as anybody running any corporation as far as I'm concerned. And then finally, your third strategy is what are you going to do about the media? Are you going to be a friend to the media? Are you going to be an enemy to the media? Remember one thing, and think about this. Now, those media only go ahead and select sources. They only select sources
which would confirm their pre-existing beliefs.
You guys walk out here.
So what a shift. He doesn't trust anyone. He's not trusting anyone. But think about it. Do they ever go to sources that don't? That don't? Do they ever publish sources that don't say certain things that they want to have ahead of time? Last time, there's a guy who's my middle son who went through Dubuque, and he played football and track. And so I said to him, and he was graduated in 3 years, and he got a student about a year before athletes, and he was a high school summer long, and he had enough credits to graduate in 3 years. So I said, why don't you take my black Hummer that I have, this ridiculous truck that I have, because of winters and winters, why don't you take it down to Dubuque? And load all your stuff in the truck. It'll be easier to bring it back. And he says, that's a great idea. I don't really want to go down to it. He comes down to Durham. And he's rooming with Sheldon Williams, Lee Melchiondi, and Charlotte Randall. And Sheldon says, Harry, do you mind if I go take the truck? I'd like to go to the supermarket to pick up some stuff. Sheldon goes out and takes the Hummer. Sheldon takes the Hummer, he's driving over here, he's driving over there. The next thing that happens is somebody gets a phone call that Sheldon Williams has just got a call from an agent. From an agent who's going to represent him in the NBA draft. So I get a phone call about 9 o'clock, and my son Harrison's picking up. He always says, he gets up the call. We have a problem. I'm sitting here watching a ball game. I'm having a great day. Someone's being very nice to me tonight. And it's a wrong way. It's not a problem. Well, our problem is that it's going to get stored in the Duke newspaper tomorrow that Sheldon Williams has accepted benefits from an agent while he was here at Duke driving around his black home. I said, let me tell you, first of all, I paid for that paper. Our Sheldon doesn't pay for anything. I pay for the insurance. It's my registration. I get all the hot money. So he says to me, what do you think you should do? I said, you ought to call Coach King. And I think you ought to go to him about this. And let Coach King. My son went ahead and did more stuff before he called the reporter at the newspaper. And he said, what's the story you're about? He said, well, Sheldon, it's my car. It's my father's car. If you want to come over and see the registration, you can come over and see the registration. You want to see any evidence, whether it's my father's car, and I just brought it down here 2 days ago, you're welcome to go ahead and see it. Well, no, I don't want to do that. That's what I'm talking about, selecting sources that go ahead and fill the existing ones. It got straightened out. Nothing ever got published. It just none of it was true. That's the kind of strategy. It's a defensive strategy, but it's a strategy that all of you have to try and employ in terms of you running the multi-billion-dollar businesses in terms of community. And I think if you can do that, if you can keep your eyes open and your radar on to these types of problems, you'll be okay to be able to do that, and you won't have to call guys like me. You go out and clean up messes that probably a lot of times you can't control everything in there. Probably you can control these types of messes. This is 589.
But I have a just chart out of that. A couple of now, a lot of them you were talking about is just a good terminal chart. It's it wouldn't matter if this was an average. A real tremendous amount of emphasis on investigation and looking at the truthfulness of it. If we were to break down the things that you think, you have a lot of athlete clients at various kinds of levels. It's sort of in wrapping this up, what is different about the representing an athlete from
representing others. And what is changing in this environment now that influences anything that you do in counseling, trying to prevent things from happening, once you've got a pile of mess there, how do you deal with it? So those two matters, what are your sort of wrap-up thoughts?
As I've said to you before, my view is that there is no different perception for the corporate executive than there is for the employee. I think both have been put on a pedestal. I think it's an egotistical crash for the athlete to be put in that position in terms of embarrassment. I do think the media without snubbing one, I do think the media is very much on the trend.
So, that point you made where there are certain categories that need to get put in.
Is that a huge part of what you've got? Yes. I think that athletes are considered to be privileged individuals. Although, I mean, as you well know, the first round picks in the NBA get a lot of money. After that, a lot of money. After that, everybody is struggling. And this suggestion now of the D-League is, to me, to me personally, is preposterous. Because no one can live off the money that these guys in the D-League are going to get. This is like some kind of privilege, but
whether they're D-League,
or whether they're the second or third round guys, or they're the first round guys, they're all treated with this celebrity status, which I think is totally fake. And I think they're all unprepared for it. So when they come into my office, I mean, what do I do? Hand them a basketball and say, would you autograph it for me? I'm just crazy. You're here in my office. Nothing like that. I have to cut everybody down to size and make them understand how serious a position they're in. And by the way, you know that I've represented some of the NFL owners, and I've had to cut them down to size. It is a very psychologically traumatic moment for these people who have all of this so-called power to now have it pulled out of their hands. And they're no longer in control. And so it's a false sense of security. And I have to go ahead and rip them down, not literally, but then build them up and get them into where they understand how serious matters are, or how potentially serious matters could be. I'm not talking that everybody comes to me has already gone ahead and done something wrong. Some people who are smart come to me and say, look, if this goes south, what are the repercussions? And I have to go ahead and I have to tell them, I have to be thankful. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not the first guy who's lost clients because I'm honest with you. Some people don't want to hear what you think. I mean, you know, somebody came to me and asked me my opinion about something. I told them they started arguing. That's what you argued with me for. You asked me for my opinion. I gave you my opinion. They didn't want my opinion. They went to another lawyer who sold them in my opinion, a bill of goods, and they proceeded to run this bill. I wasn't happy for them. It's just the facts. It's like, you know, going to a physician. You know, you don't like what you heard from the first physician, so you go to another physician. That's it.
Any questions for Jill? How did you get into this specific kind of working with athletes and how did that happen? Was that something that was planned or did it kind of just arrive?
So most of the time, I've been known in America today. There are not that many trials going on anymore. Okay? I think you've learned in law school that there's mediation and arbitration. I'm one of the guys who goes to court almost all the time. Right? So what happens is a lot of lawyers that I know don't want to go to court. They don't want to get in the heat. They don't want to be having sleepless nights with someone. I'm just one of these guys. I'm up at 5 o'clock in the morning. My motor's going. Okay? That's just who I am. I'm competitive. I like the action. I like the honor. A lot of people don't have the trouble. So what happens is they call me. They see me. Other times people have heard of the success I've had in certain matters, and they come and they hear about it too. To be very frank with you, I don't I don't have a publicity agent. I don't ever want to be in the newspapers. My mark is to be proactive and be discreet about it. Important people who need to know me are the U.S. attorneys, the Justice Department people, different prosecutors. They know me. And I think they respect me because I'm not a media account. But to answer your question, people just have seen me deal with certain people. Word has gotten out. It's been a word of my word. I don't go to the Sports Lawyers Conference, for example. And see issues like that. I've been invited. It's very nice to meet people. No, that's just how it is. I did not focus. I'm sorry, I didn't answer your question. I did not focus on student athletes. I concentrated on people who were charged with criminal offenses, and then it just worked its way around. It turned out that some of them were athletes, and then one thing led to another. And, you know, I have relationships with people. Ohio State, I have relationships with people at Purdue, Michigan, at SC, at Syracuse. They know what I've done. I've been at this for about 40 years. And the other day, when one of my sons was complaining that I've been a great success, I said, yes, in 40 years, we have an overnight success. So, I mean, come on. That's just the way it is. It's just time, put your time in, and that's it.
Jake had a question, but we did hear one problem. You worked for Ohio State and Michigan.
Yes. They both have their problems.
So, another class you talked about college athletes who are the judge in the court after being before, if it wasn't making any of these things to be honest. And it's as though, you know, schools have different procedures and policies in place to deal with these
things. That's disruptive. That's the problem. They all have different procedures.
Well, that's what leads to my question. It seems there's been a trend recently where schools are more willing to defend their reputation and for the athlete. So I was curious, do you know what the policies are in this field? You have a couple of institutions, policies, or procedures that the university implemented that could protect the athletes better at the same time, uphold at least the kinds of uphold some of the criticism and attacks that universities will perceive not being attacked or not.
I don't think uniformity is a possibility. I really don't. I think all these institutions have some personal philosophy. Just look at the Ivy League. They're out on an island and they don't care. They don't care because they have the largest endowments in the country. They don't care. I mean, everybody talks about this whole thing about Big Five conferences. The Big Five conferences leaving the NCAA. Does anybody ask the Ivy League whether they even care about this issue? Because they're loaded. They don't care. They don't care. So I don't think uniformity is possible because I think there is an institutional ego for every one of these universities. And that is to say, don't tell us how to manage the educational process. And my response to that all the time is, you're violating due process. It's not even a question about it. And you don't care. All they care about is the reputational component of the university. Just like you want to do pro team. You don't care about how it's the guy who's drug dropping, suspend him, and your team will be okay. You've cleansed yourself and everything is alright. It's just protecting the product. That's what it's about. Forget the person. There are high profile college athletes that you smile all over the place. James Winston, right? The guy from Florida State. But they're field hockey players if you're thrown out of school for drinking in the dorm, or doing drugs.